Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Hey, listen, I'm going to get down on my knees in just a moment. I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer. But before we do, I want to give you a quick reminder. Every service from every pastor, you'll hear this. You don't come to church to hear from a man. Please, please, please don't ever come to hear from men. Whatever men have to say, we don't want to hear. We want to hear what God has to say. So don't come to hear from Luke or from Dan or from Pastor Jim or anything like that. Come to hear from God. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher today. And as I do it, I'd like to ask if you're able to stand, if you could join me in prayer. And let's prepare our hearts to receive the word of the Lord today. And let's condition ourselves to get ready for the word of God. So Father, we come into this place today and we are just so grateful for the opportunity to be here, Lord. We thank you that we don't come for tradition. We don't come for ritual. We don't come to hear from a man or from a woman, from the young or the older, anything like that, Lord. We come into this place to hear from you. And we fully acknowledge that it's your precious son, Jesus, who is the senior leader of this church. And so, Lord, it's in your magnificent name that we ask that your Holy Spirit would be with us today, Lord, to be our counselor, to be our teacher, would be our the one that guides us into all truth, Lord. We thank you that you would correct us in things in our life that need correction, Lord, and encourage us in the areas that need encouragement today. And Lord, we thank you that your word would be like a seed planted into good and fertile ground, the ground being our hearts, that as we walk out of this place, that we would cultivate that seed and bear much fruit for the kingdom and the glory of God. And Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we say today a special prayer on my heart, Lord, for our brothers and sisters around the world. There are so many things that are going on around the church globally, Lord, that we just ask that your hand will be upon our brothers and sisters, specifically today our Christian brothers and sisters in the continent of Africa that are enduring such horrific persecutions. And Lord, and those that are fleeing for their lives in Iraq right now, Lord, we just ask that your hand would be upon your church in Iraq and around the world that are facing tremendous persecution for you, Lord. We thank you that your word says that they hated Jesus before all, and Lord, they'll hate us for you, but Lord, be of good cheer because you have overcome the world. So, Lord, we thank you that we, your church, are more than overcomers despite horrific circumstances. And so, Lord, we thank you for all of our brothers and sisters all around the world. Today, Lord, we ask that you would bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, guide them, and guard them. Lord, we thank you. To you be the praise and the glory and the honor in all that you do. And Lord, we say that your kingdom come, and Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Well, praise God. As you grab your seat, go ahead and get your Bibles out. Go with me to the book of Hebrews in the 10th chapter. Really neat section of scripture. We're going to resume our line upon line, precept upon precept study of the book of Hebrews, picking off exactly where we were yesterday, or last week, I should say. And I'm excited for what God's got in store. I know this is going to be a great message. The title of this morning is simply this: Follow the Leader. Follow the leader. Now, if you were with us last week, you know that we talked about access to God, that we have boldness. We learned that boldness is not arrogance, but confidence, assurance. So we have assurance in going before the presence of God. We learned the week prior to that, that we have a calling to be bold in our lives and some things that hinder our lives as bold Christians and things that we can do to be bold. And so today, with that idea in mind, I want to take some things, I want to show you some things that as I was teaching last week about the access that we have to the throne of God, to the presence of God, some things that the Holy Spirit imparted upon my heart that to teach us, the church, some things that we need to understand about following the leader. So let me take you there to Hebrews in the 10th chapter, verse number 19 again, where we were. We're going to look at the same portion of scripture that we've been there for a couple of weeks, but I want to point something out to you today. In Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 19, it says, "Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus." Very important that it's the blood of Jesus. You'll see as we progress through the scriptures today that it's the blood of Jesus that washes us. It's that sacrifice. So we have boldness to access the holiest, or the presence, the most holy place where God himself dwells, because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Now verse number 20 goes on and it tells us, by a new and living way. What an amazing statement. We'll get there in the next couple of weeks, I'm sure, as we discuss the book of Hebrews. But it says, by which he, speaking of Jesus consecrated us, or washed us, cleansed us through the veil. Now if you've got your Bibles, I want you to do something. If you've got a Bible and a pen or a marker or a highlighter, I want you to highlight, underline, or just make that "through the veil" statement stick out, because you're going to see some very interesting and important truths today as we discuss that. So Jesus consecrated us through the veil, that is his flesh. Now verse number 21 goes on And it says, having a high priest, Jesus Christ. We've discussed this over the months. Jesus is our high priest. He's our representative. He's our ambassador. He's our mediator. He's the one that is seated at the right hand of the throne of God, making intercession for you and I, pleading on our behalf to God the Father. Jesus is now there, a high priest over the house of God. And verse number 22 tells us now to, with full assurance, draw near with a true heart in the full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled with from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. So here what we're seeing is that it's the access we have. We have the ability to draw near. As we discussed last week, the presence of God was something that men would typically walk away from. You see, going into the holiest place where God dwelt was a place of reverence, a place of fear that you only went if you were the high priest, and you only went once a year. You could not go unless you went through each of the steps and the processes that God had set before. It was a place of tremendous reverence. And so here men typically would draw away when we saw that God had ascended upon or descended upon the Mount Zion, that the people said, Moses, you speak to us. We can't even hear from God. But now we see that we have boldness and assurance to go into the presence of God, to draw near to God, because it was Jesus who first went before us. It was by the blood of Jesus. It was by the consecration of Jesus. It was because a new and living way Jesus had brought forth to us, that he is our high priest, our mediator, our ambassador. So it is now Jesus who we follow into the throne room of God. You may have heard the statement before, but there's a statement that oftentimes you hear. It's, there are many ways to skin a cat. Anybody ever heard that before? I have no clue where that statement actually came from. Some of you cat lovers, I know you're thinking, man, I hate that statement. I detest that statement. Some of you who don't like cats, you say, I have no problems with that statement. The thing is that there may be many ways to skin a cat, but there is only one way into the presence of God, into the throne room of God, and that is through Jesus Christ. You see, it's human nature for you and I to try to find a way around the obstacle. That's why we have statements like that. If you're a parent, you ever have a child, you know exactly what I'm talking about, because your child might come to you and say, hey, can I have a cookie, or can I have chocolate, or can I have this? And you know what's best for them, so you say no. Well, what happens right after that? They go to mom, or they go to dad, or they go to grandma and grandpa, or they'll try to go around you to get what they want. But you see, the thing is that you and I cannot access the presence of God, the holiest place of God, the separation between righteous God and sinful man on our own. There is only one way, and that is through Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us, Jesus himself says this in John, the 14th chapter. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He says here, Jesus said to them, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one, look to your neighbor and say, no one. No one goes to the Father except through me. Now, do you remember on Hebrews, I had you highlight or circle or underline through the veil. You see, if you recall, the veil was the thick curtain that was made by man that separated the holiest from the holy place to the holy of holies, or the most holy place. It was a place that was a separation between the presence of righteous God and sinful man. Only one person could pass through that veil one day a year, the high priest only. So now it says, no one can go to the Father except through me. And Hebrews tells us that we have access, boldness to go into the holiest, the presence of God Almighty, with full assurance of faith to draw near. Why? Because Jesus Christ, through his flesh, the veil, now you and I enter the presence of God. The physical cloth was torn from top to bottom when Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. And now he has replaced that veil, and now it is him, the blood and the flesh of Jesus Christ, that we pass through as we follow the leader into the presence of God. Let me say it like this. Jesus brought us to a place of exclusive access because we are united with him. There was a time before Pastor Eddie, who is now the senior pastor of the Rock Church of Coachella Valley, when he was here. For those of you, many of you know, but for those of you that don't know, Pastor Eddie is a two-time world champion skateboarder, and he was our youth pastor. And there was a time when everybody knows who Pastor Eddie is in the skateboarding world, because he mentored a lot of the guys that are real big, the big names now. And we were having church, and Pastor Eddie got a phone call from Tony Hawk. Tony Hawk is one of the biggest names in skateboarding history. And Tony Hawk called Pastor Eddie and says, hey, man, we got this arena tour that we're going all around the United States with a bunch of of guys on skateboards, with a bunch of guys on BMX, with a bunch of guys on motorcycles, and we have this tour where we're going to be skating, we're going to be doing these ramps with the bikes and the BMXing, and at the same time, we're going to have motorcycles and everything's going to be jumping over. It's all this choreographed show or spectacle of extreme sports. And he says, we're right here in San Bernardino, practicing at the airport in one of the hangars. They had their entire arena tour set up, the big ramps and the loops and all the things and the TV crew. And he says, come check us out. So Pastor Eddie says to me and a couple of the younger guys, hey, come with me. So we went, we drove up to San Bernardino Airport and we drove through the security checkpoints, and there at the hangar door, there was a big security guard. As the security guard says, you know, who are you guys? And he says, well, my name's Eddie Algarry. Oh, okay, cool. He opens up the door, says, come on in. And in there was the ramp and the loop and all these guys, and they're doing their practicing. The TV crews are there. There's the security teams walking around. They've got the lights and the smoke and the pyrotechnics all going off. It's a dress rehearsal for this show that they're going to go nationally take around. And as we're going about, we had full access to anywhere we wanted to go. So we're walking, we're following with Pastor Eddie. All of a sudden, all these big names start seeing Pastor Eddie, Tony Hawk and Bob Burnquist and all these guys. Hey, 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 there's Eddie. So they all come, and there's this big circle of all these big athletes in the extreme sports world. And they're talking to Pastor Eddie. And there we are discussing in this circle with these guys. You know, when we walked up to that hangar, the security guard didn't ask me what my name was. He didn't say, oh, your name's Luke? Oh, cool, come on in, man, right on, yeah, come on. Tony Hawk didn't see me and say, hey, he didn't call me up and say, hey, come check me out. Come hang out with us tonight. Why? Because I wasn't given the access. I wasn't given the invitation. Pastor Eddie was, and because we followed Pastor Eddie, because we were with him, we were given access just as though we were him. We were able to walk around. We were able to participate in the conversation, to introduce ourselves and to meet these guys. It was a really neat opportunity. Why? Because Pastor Eddie said, hey, it's okay. These guys are with me. You see, you and I have access to the throne of God. You and I have faith. You and I have assurance. You and I have boldness in our lives. Why? Not because of something that we did, but because Jesus Christ has gone first before us. He tore the veil, and he says, now at the throne room of God, he says, hey, it's okay. They're with me. And now we have that assurance to be in the presence of God. So today I want to talk about the followers of Christ and being a follower of Christ. Now, we talked about that today, and I have decided to follow Jesus. We sang that song. But what I want to do is, I don't want to just say, oh, we need to be followers of Christ. I want to look at some characteristics of followers of Christ. And some of these characteristics, they won't necessarily be the amen, hoot, and holler, and hallelujah. They might be more of an oh me or oh my characteristic. But I promise by the end of the message, you will be encouraged, you will be strengthened, you'll be lifted up, because these are some characteristics that you and I, as followers of Christ, need to have in our life. So today we're going to look at some of the characteristics of followers as we learn to follow the leader, Jesus, who has gone before us. Okay, are you guys with me today? Right on. Today we're taking a look at the life of a follower, or followers of Jesus, and we'll complete that statement. Followers of Jesus, we'll complete that statement four times today. Followers of Jesus, number one for this morning, leave all behind. Followers of Jesus, leave all behind. You see, when we come into a new life with Jesus Christ, the Bible describes us as new creations. Paul goes on and he says that old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. So literally, when we are followers, or we become followers of Christ, what is happening to you and I is our old person, our old personality, who we once were, literally dies. And now we are a new creation. So sometimes we say, man, Pastor Luke, I don't feel like a new creation. Pastor Luke, I don't feel like there's any difference in me. But let me tell you something. When we are followers of Christ, and when we leave ourselves behind and we go forward for Christ, that is when the new creation begins to start in us. You think of it like this, that the Bible refers to us as our old man as being dead. It's buried in the ground. I don't know about any of you in this place, but I know that none of us would want to go to a cemetery today and start digging up dead people. Why? Because after a couple of days, the person who's dead starts to smell, right? A couple of weeks, starts to decay. After a couple of years, it's just not a pretty story. So why would we, if we're following Jesus, why would we want to turn back and try to dig up that which is dead, that which is decaying, that which is rotting? But we have got to leave ourselves behind and follow Jesus Christ. It's really easy for us to leave that which we don't like behind. Well, God, I'm going to leave my anger behind. God, I'm going to leave my alcohol behind. God, I'm going to leave my past and the things that I'm ashamed of behind. But what about the things that we like about ourselves? Well, God, I feel like I'm smart. I feel like I'm talented. I feel like this is me or this is my personality. But you see, we have got to learn to leave all behind because it is no longer us, but is now God inside of us. As a matter of fact, Paul the Apostle says in Galatians, I'll just put it up on the overhead. Galatians in the second chapter, Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ, which means I am now dead. It is no longer I, myself, Paul, who's saying this. It is no longer Luke Cobray who lives, but now it is Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I'm still alive physically, but it's no longer who I once was. Now I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul goes on and he starts to discuss in Philippians, the third chapter. He starts to talk about if there's anybody who has a reason to brag, it's me. I was born of the tribe of Benjamin. I was circumcised on the eighth day, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. I was taught with the greatest of teachers. I was given everything in my life. He says, I've got a reason to brag. But Paul says, I count it all as waste because that is no longer who I am. That is all garbage to me now because that was who I once was. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter how low or how high you are on the economic status of this world. As followers of Christ, you and I have got to learn to leave it all behind and now accept our new identity in Jesus Christ. Thank you for the one or two. That's all right. I know. You're like, man. The Bible tells us in the book of Matthew that Jesus sees some men fishing. In Matthew, the fourth chapter, he sees a man by the name of Peter and his brother Andrew. And he says to Peter and Andrew, hey, come follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. The Bible says immediately they left their nets and followed him. Going on, he sees another group of brothers, a man by the name of James, a man by the name of John with their father Zebedee in the fishing boat. And he says, hey, come follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. And the Bible says immediately they left their nets and their father and got out of the boat and followed Jesus. Why? They left everything that was about them behind. But isn't it so coincidental that when life happens, when you're going through life and you hit a road bump, or when something's going on, you hit a speed bump or a hurdle in your life, isn't it so funny how it's just coincidence that somebody from the old just happens to pop up? Somebody that you haven't talked to in years, somebody that you lost communication with, but right then at that very moment, hey man, what's going on? Hey, I got a cold beer for you. Hey, come on over to my house and get it fixed. I see like you're going down. Hey man, come on, let's talk and let's just shoot the breeze and talk about the good old days. And see, we want to try to return to that old person, but we've got to remember that as followers of Christ, we are no longer that old person. That person is dead. That person no longer exists, but now we are new in Christ and we are leaving it all behind. So followers of Christ, leave it all behind. Looking at number two for today, followers of Jesus. Number two, live sacrificially. That's another one of those, oh man, I should have gone to Calvary Chapel today, Pastor Luke. No, let me give you the critical difference. When I say followers of Christ, leave it all behind, I'm speaking to the life and everything behind. So as you progress in life, imagine that there is a trail or a train of things, of memories, of events, of accolades, of failures in your life. And as you follow Christ, you say, I will cut the tie right here. And as I move forward, that no longer follows me. That is no longer my identity. That is leaving it all behind. The difference now between leaving it all behind and living sacrificially is looking forward, saying there are things in my life that now I will give up because God has asked me to. There are things in my life that I will sacrifice on a continual basis, that I will give up, not just in my past, but in my future, because the plan or the will of God for me is to go this way and not that. So we are not only to call to leave our past behind, but also to live a sacrificial life continually, day after day, giving up ourselves, our will. That's why in our prayer we say, not our will, but yours be done, because God's desire for us is a sacrificial life. In Romans in the 12th chapter, Romans in chapter number 12, verse number 1, Paul the Apostle speaking to the church says, brethren, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. What an amazing statement here Paul the Apostle says. You remember in Hebrews that it says, by a new and living way, Jesus Christ consecrated us. That we have access. Why? Because Jesus came and he gave a sacrifice, but it was a sacrifice of death. He was nailed to the cross and died for our sins. But you see, it was a new and living way. Why? Because on the third day, he rose again with life from power on high. And Jesus now is alive, seated at the right hand of God, the Father, making intercession for us. So we live a life of a living sacrifice, which means we may have to put to death our flesh, but we don't have to die to life. Why? Because we have been given life not in the flesh, not in the world, not in our desires, but now we have been given life by Jesus Christ to no longer thirst, to no longer hunger for the things, but rather go after the life of Jesus Christ and to live it more abundantly. So it is a sacrifice that we lay down our lives, but in return we receive life at the same time. A living sacrifice. Paul the Apostle goes on and says, which is acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. That's a whole message on its own of reasonable service unto God. God did this for you. You have accepted the gift of salvation. Now, in return, you are to live a living sacrifice, a life of continual giving towards God. When we had our firstborn, Bjorn, we have 10 nephews and one niece just on mom and dad, Pastor Jim's side of the family, just between my sisters, my three sisters, 10 nephews and one niece. So when we had our firstborn child, unbeknownst to us, everybody in my family had saved everything for us. So it's like we came home with the baby and it was like back the truck up, open the garage and dump it all in. All right, everybody was like, I got room in my attic. I got room in my closet. It's all yours now. And part of that, we inherited clothes, we inherited toys. And Stacy and I, we're the kind of personality, we have a hard time giving away or giving up or throwing away things that were given to us because we see that there was a value in that gift. So we have been collecting all these clothes and all these toys. And so we started putting all the toys in a closet. We call it the toy closet. And it literally became like you see in the cartoons or in the comic books. You know, you open the door and it's like this tidal wave of toys that just spill out. It's supposed to be the coat closet of our house, and you can't put a coat in there because it would just be toys flooding out. So we finally just said, all right, we're fed up with this. We can't handle this. We give all the kids all the toys they want, and then go and play with a water bottle anyways. So we got some trash bags, and we got the toys together, and we started putting them in bags. And we said, hey, listen, we're going to give them away. We're going to give them to people that need them. We'll take some of them to Goodwill. We'll take some of them to the church where the church can give them away to the kids that needs them. And so we have all these toys laid out in bags. And I remember my three-year-old boy comes up, and he says to us, as he sees, as you know, you think of the life of a three-year-old, he sees toys and trash bags, not good. So he says, Dad, what are you doing? So we sit him down. We say, Bjorn, you know, you have so many toys that you don't play with, and there are kids around this world that don't have anything to play with, and don't you think that we should take some of your toys and give them away and give them to kids that have need, and you can make them happy, and they can play with your toys? And he was like, okay. And so he said, well, why don't you help us? And so go in your closet, and you pick out 5 of your toys, and we'll put it in the bag, and we'll give it away to the kids, and you can know that you've made somebody happy. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, man, how cute. Man, Pastor Luke and Pastor Stacy, they're teaching their kids the ways of God. Their kids have such a tender heart. Jesus says that you must enter in as a kingdom of God. Let me set your mind at ease. My son did not come back with 5 of his favorite toys. He came back with 5 broken or unused toys. He came back with the set that a 3-month-old would play with, not what a 3-year-old would want to play with, and said, here, Dad, give him this. You see, the thing is, though, in our lives, when it comes to sacrifice, it's easy to give up things that we don't care much about. It's easy to say, God, well, you know what? You can have this area of my life. God, you can have this area of my life. God, I'll give this to you over here. But this over here, hey, this is a little bit too close. This is off limits. This is where I'm. Don't come over here in this area. This is mine. Well, you see, God's desire for us is to live a living sacrifice, to give up in our lives what needs to be given up so that we can serve God effectively and that we can have life according to God's will and according to God's way in our lives, because we are followers of Jesus leading us into the presence of God Almighty. So we've got to learn to live a sacrificial life. Number 3 for this morning, followers of Jesus. Followers of Jesus. This is where it starts to get a little bit more of an amen instead of oh me, so you can take a deep breath, all right? Followers of Jesus, number 3, always stay focused on Jesus. Always stay focused on Him. Have you ever been at a job or at training somewhere, when somebody's teaching you how to do something, hey, I'm going to give you the skills, or I'm going to show you how to do this, you've got to watch. You've got to keep your eyes on them. You've got to listen to what they're saying and what they're telling you. Why? Because there's going to be a day when you will have to do what they showed you how to do. And if you don't keep your eyes on them, if you don't pay attention, if you're not fixed on what they're telling you, when it comes time, you'll miss out. And as followers of Jesus, we have got to stay focused, to remain fixed on Jesus. As mankind, as humanity, we get so easily ensnared or get so easily wrapped up in things around us. Well, I'm following Jesus, but that person over there is getting more blessed than I am. So guess what? I'll start looking at what they're doing. Or I'll start looking at over here as churches. On the bigger picture, we say, well, they over there, they've got the lights and the mirrors and the smoke, or they sing this type of a song, or they do this, or they do that. We should do what they're doing because God is moving on them. But God is saying all along, my desire is not for you to follow man, to look at what they're doing or to the left, to the right, to get so easily entrapped or so easily wrapped up in the things around us, but rather to not follow man, but to follow the man, Jesus Christ, who is leading us into the presence of God. We have got to remain fixed. That's why the Bible tells us, don't grow weary while doing good, for in due time we'll receive if we don't lose heart. Why? Because we don't look to the left or we don't look to the right. We don't worry about what's going on. We keep our eyes fixated on Jesus Christ because that is where our destination is ahead of us, the presence of God. And that is what gives us the assurance to go into the presence of God. I remember a couple of weeks ago, we were on vacation. And we were in Mammoth Lakes up in the mountains, and there's about 9 or 10 different lakes in the basin right there where you can go and you can rent boats or you can just go fishing on the shore or just hang out and whatever it was. So the whole family decided to get together, and we're going to go caravan to one of these lakes for the day. We're going to have a picnic and hang out and let the kids maybe try to rent a boat from one of the marinas. Well, it was a weekend afternoon, so in the middle of the afternoon on a weekend in the lakes basin, it was crowded. You couldn't go anywhere. It was traffic jams up in the mountains because everybody congregates to the same place. And so here we were, my white truck, Pastor Dan and Pastor Jess's van, my sister's SUV, and there we were driving in a line in a caravan. And we would stop into one parking lot of one marina to see if there was room, and we would all wait, and somebody would jump out. Okay, there's no, we'd go to the next one and stop and wait. And so finally, we pull into this one marina, and there's parking spots everywhere. So I pull in, I'm the last one in the caravan, I'm the last one, the last car, I pull into the first parking spot. They're driving, I say, oh, there's a parking spot. They're looking for a close one. So my wife and I and our kids, we're sitting in the car waiting, hanging out, waiting for somebody to come knock on our window, say, hey, we got a boat, or we're gonna have lunch right here, or we're gonna go sit down right here by the lake and hang out. After about five or 10 minutes, we're like, hey, nobody's knocked on our window. So I get out of the car, I look around, I don't see anybody's car parked here. So we get out, we start driving around, we get totally lost. We start driving to every lake in the basin. Where is everybody at? And the whole time in my mind, I'm thinking, man, my family's ridiculous. They don't even care about me. They're such jerks. They just drove away. Who cares about what Luke's doing? He's gonna do his own thing. And I'm complaining, we're all mad. Stacy and I are starting to get at each other. Let's just go home, forget it. They can do their own thing. Finally, we pull over to a spot on the side of the road, and we get out, and you know, in the mountains, sometimes you have to, like, wave your phone around. Finally, I hear my chime, ding, it's my dad, where are you? I text him back, where are you? Hello. So they say, oh, we're parked here, so we know where they're at, so we finally get our way back there. I'm all mad, I'm at getting out of the car, slamming the door, looking at everybody, like, giving them that look, you know, thanks a lot, here we are, finally. Unbeknownst to me, as we drove, I pulled into a parking spot. I drive a white Toyota. As I pulled into a parking spot, a white Toyota pulled out of another parking spot and followed them. As they were driving down the road, there's another white Toyota. So they're looking in their rearview mirror like, hey, trains are rolling, let's keep on going. They pull into the parking lot, this little parking lot with like 5 spaces. The white truck pulls up right next to them and parks. They have no clue. All of a sudden, they realize Luke and Stacy aren't in that truck. We're fighting somewhere in the mountains. Why? Because we took our eyes off the caravan. We weren't leading. We were the caboose of the caravan, and we parked into our own parking spot saying, this is good. But you see, what happens in life is we pull into our own parking spots. God, I'm happy right here. This is good. This must be what you have for me. And God says, no, 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 no. Don't stop. Don't park. Keep your eyes, because we're keep rolling through. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews in the 12th chapter. Now, I know you're asking, Pastor Luke, how can you use Hebrews chapter 12 to explain Hebrews chapter 10? The reason is in order to get through Hebrews chapter 12, we got to go through chapter 11. And that's called the Hall of Faith. And I know we're going to be there for a long time. So by the time we get to this, you probably won't even remember this. So Hebrews in the 12th chapter, verse number 1, it says, therefore, since we also are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight, leave it all behind, and sin which easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Verse number 2 says, looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, with our eyes fixed on Jesus. The New Living Translation says, we do this, we run this race, we hit the goal. Why? Because we keep our eyes on Jesus. Keeping our eyes on Jesus. You see, followers of Christ keep their eyes on Him. Now, let me give you a little bit of encouragement for those of you in this place. You say, man, maybe I missed the mark. Maybe I parked in a parking lot, and now I feel like I've missed the train. Praise God that God is a God who never leaves us nor forsakes us, but rather all you have to do is cry out to God, and you will be found. My son was with my wife just the other day, and he walked away. He got his eyes off of Mom, and he started crying because he thought Mom left him in the shopping market. And all she had to do is call his name, and around the corner, he heard her name, and all of a sudden, there he was, reunited with Mom. Just because your eyes have been taken off or you've been distracted to the left or the right doesn't mean that your life is over or that it's over for you, but rather to stop what you're doing and get reconnected with God and keep your eyes fixed on Jesus Christ so that you don't miss out again. Followers of Christ, keep our eyes on Him. Last one for today, followers of Jesus. Last one for today. This is where it's really at right here too. Followers of Jesus, say and do what He does. Now that is cool. Why is that cool? Because you're starting to think, well, Pastor Luke, Jesus said some things and people walked away from Him. Jesus died on the cross. He lived a life of sacrifice. That's kind of heavy. Let's think about that. Yeah, He did that. But also, Jesus said some very profound things. Jesus said some things that were inspired by the Word of God. Jesus did some and performed some great miracles in His life. And even though Jesus sacrificed, and even though Jesus said the hard things to mankind, He also said the things of God. And Jesus said, the words that I speak are not of me, but of my Father. The things that I do are not of me, but are of my Father. You see, you and I, as Christians, are to do and say what Christ does. The term Christian literally meant little Christs, like mini-me's around the world. It was actually a derogatory term of little Christs kind of causing ruckus in Jerusalem and Antioch doing their thing. But you see, God has not called us to be little Christs on earth, but rather God has called us to be big Christians, followers of Christ, effective in our lives, effective in our families, to do great and mighty things, to see signs, wonders, and miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, confirming the Word of God because we say and we do what Jesus Christ does. Jesus in John, the 14th chapter. Jesus in John the 14th chapter says this. He says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. That is a pretty cool statement right there. Forget the rest of it. Jesus says, what I do, you'll do. Did you know that Jesus fed 5,000? Did you know that Jesus fed 4,000? Did you know that Jesus healed the leper? That Jesus cleansed the sick? That Jesus raised the dead to life? Jesus did these amazing things, and Jesus is now saying to His disciples, to you and I, His followers, that which I do, you will do also. But He doesn't stop there. Why? He says, greater works than these will He do. Why? Because I go to my Father. Jesus says, I have made the way. Now Jesus in the presence of God Almighty is saying, God, hey, them down there, them right here, they're with me. So everything that I say, everything that I did by your power, Lord, let them say and let them do by your power. You see, there was only one Jesus that lived on the earth, but now there are billions of Christians that walk the earth. So could you imagine if we do and say what He does and greater, what this world would look like? Just think back to the generation that we live in. We have seen in the past 100 years, men like Billy Graham, men like Reinhard Bonnke, men things like the Azusa Street Revival or the Charismatic Outpouring, or we've seen things like healing revivals from Catherine Kuhlman or John G. Lake or Kenneth Hagin and so forth and so on. The things that have gone on around the globe in the name of Jesus have gone far and above what just one man in Jerusalem did. Why? Because we have been given the ability, because of our access to God, to do and say what Jesus Christ does, which means we don't live life busted, disgusted, down in the dumps. Oh me, nobody knows the trouble I am. Hopefully someday I'll get into the presence of God. Jesus says, I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. And while you're here on earth, you will perform miracles, signs, and wonders and gifts of the Holy Spirit to confirm my word. Just a couple of chapters over in the book of Acts, after Jesus tells his disciples this, the Bible says that they were in a place called Solomon's Portico. And they healed a man, and there was this great controversy with the leadership of the Jewish leaders there. And they stayed there in the portico of Solomon. And the Bible says that they brought multitudes to the disciples, to the apostles, laying them at their feet. They said that from all over the region, they brought the sick and the afflicted, and they were healed. And that they brought them so that they would, in hopes that the shadow of Peter might just simply cross over them, that they might be healed. They performed great wonders and miracles. Paul the apostle laid hands on rags and sent them out to the sick. And people who touched the rags were healed by the power of God. Now, church, you and I are called to do greater things in the name of Jesus that was accomplished. Why? Because we are God's dream team here in the last days to get the word of God out to a lost and a dying world as followers of Christ. Man, I'll tell you, if that doesn't excite you, you need to check your pulse. So today we talked about the followers of Christ looking at following the leader. Followers of Christ leave it all behind. It's no longer who live, but now Christ who lives in me. Followers of Christ live sacrificially. I will never give to God that which costs me nothing, but always give to God what costs me something in my life. Followers of God, number three today. Followers of God today, we always stay focused on Him. And last one for today, we do and say what He does. Last thought for today, really neat revelation that I was just given a couple of months ago by Dr. Barron. What you declare Jesus Christ in your life is what He will be. Look at this. Billy Graham declared Jesus Christ to be salvation, and millions were saved under Billy Graham. Reinhard Bonnke declared Jesus Christ to be salvation and healing, and millions were saved and healed under the power of Jesus Christ. So what is Christ in your life? Is He your grace? Is He your strength? Is He your mercy? Is He your ability? Is He your salvation? Is He your rock of help? Is He that one that lifts you up when you feel down? You see, what you declare Jesus Christ to be in your life will determine what He is in your life. And that is why, church, it is so essential for us to follow the leader. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Thank you guys for remaining seated and being here today. I just want to ask you, just give me a moment more of your time. Please don't get up. Please don't walk around. It'd be a travesty for us to leave today on the pretenses that everybody in this room is okay with God, when really there's people in this place that are not. The fact that we've worshiped, the fact that we've heard the Word of God talking about being followers of Christ, I want to ensure today, make sure today, that each and every person in this room is in the right position with God. And I'm going to ask you this question. I want you to examine your heart, examine your life. The Bible says for us to examine ourselves. So think about this in your heart and in your head. Nobody would know this answer but you and God. If you were to die today, if you were to walk out of this place and your heart were to stop beating, bang, and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Simple question. You know, you might say, well, Pastor Luke, I hope so. I think so. I want to. I expect to go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you hope, because you want to, because you desire, because you expect to get to heaven, because you've got positive outlook on life, that you're going to get to heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you went to Sunday school or Sabbath school classes or catechism classes, because your parents told you you were a Christian, that you attend church, that you're going to get into heaven, like God's going to give you the gold star for attendance, and that means that you get enough? Nowhere in the Bible are you going to find that. You can't find it in the Bible that because you call yourself a Christian that you're going to get into heaven. You can't find it in the Bible that because you're a good person. Oh my goodness, Pastor Luke, I do good things. I've never robbed a 7-Eleven. I've never cheated on my taxes. I give to humanitarian aid and world efforts and things like that. I try to do good for my fellow human. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, you're going to get into heaven? But the reality is that the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. Nothing you and I could ever do in our own lives would make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because God's standard for entrance into heaven is perfection. Yet the Bible says that each and every person living on this earth has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All except one, Jesus Christ, who came and lived a perfect life, born of God, to lead us into a way, to follow the leader. And Jesus, as He's discussing the subject of eternal life with a man in the Bible, you can read it in the book of John in the 3rd chapter. Jesus is talking to a man by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus, the Bible describes him as a Pharisee, a leader of the Jews. He was an educated man, a religious man. He was a man that knew the scriptures. He was a man that gave to the poor, did all the right things. And Jesus, as they're talking about the subject of eternal life, you would think that Jesus says to Nicodemus, man, you just keep on going, doing your thing. Great is your reward in heaven. But Jesus says to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, in order to inherit eternal life, you must be born again. There it is. Born again. That's God's way. You say, man, Pastor, I know what you're talking about. I've seen that on the movies and on the sitcoms. Listen, Hollywood society culture has made a mockery out of that term. You think of radical, crazy, weirdo, out of control Christianity. But let me tell you something. Born again is not defined by what society says. It's defined by what God says. And what God says from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing. Here it is. God's after all of your heart. God's after all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's not about your mental ascent towards God. It's not about your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. I already know you know who Jesus is. That's why you're here today. Did you know that the Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know and believe that Jesus is the Son of God, yet they're not on their way to heaven? It's about giving God all of your heart. It's about giving God all of your life. Let me prove it to you again in the Bible. The book of Revelation. Jesus Christ is speaking to the church, people like you and I, listening to the Word of God, hearing the Word of God, doing good things. And Jesus says this. He says he's coming back. And when he comes back, he better find us hot or he better find us cold. Because if he finds us lukewarm, he says he will vomit us from his mouth. Shocking statement. And what Jesus Christ is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all and will be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. Well, what does lukewarm mean? Let's define that. Let's clarify that. Lukewarm simply means that you're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You're doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing a little bit of God, doing a little bit of the world. You're riding the fence. And Jesus says that that's you. You're deceived in thinking that you're going to make it into the kingdom of God. And listen, I love you enough. I respect you enough. I honor you enough to tell you the truth. Can't get to heaven based on your own devices. Can't get to heaven because somebody told you that's how you get to heaven. The only way you and I can get to heaven is God's way. And that's through Jesus. We read it today. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do it any other way but God's way. So today, here's what I want to do. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three. When I count to three, I'm going to give you the opportunity to ensure your place. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go one, two, on the count of three, I'm going to go three. I'm going to go bang. And when I clap my hand together, just like that, what I'm asking you to do, I'm asking you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, hey, Pastor Luke, today, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, today, I want to make sure I get into heaven. I'm a man, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down. You see, that's important because Jesus said that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. But if you deny him before men, he'll deny you before his Father. The decision's yours. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. God's already done everything he could to ensure your place in heaven forever and ever by giving Jesus Christ a beaten, bloody mess to hang naked on the cross for our sin and our shame. You say, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I might be embarrassed. Somebody might see me. You know, you might feel a moment of embarrassment. But let me encourage you to get over that moment of embarrassment, because wouldn't it be better to be embarrassed for a moment than to miss out on heaven forever and ever and ever and ever and ever? The choice is yours. Let's get a right understanding of God. Listen, God's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to whack you over the head for the things that you've done. God's not a kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up. God loved you so much, he gave Jesus Christ, the beaten, bloody mess, to die on a cross for your and my sins together. He gave everything for you and I, and in return, he wants our heart and he wants our life. So today, I want to encourage you, if that's you, in just a moment, get ready. Be bold, don't be ashamed of it. Today is a new day for you. Who should raise their hands? If you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life, in just a moment, if that's you, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge you and put it right back down. Who should raise their hands? Maybe you're not sure. Maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group or in the Billy Graham or Harvest Crusade, but you never really followed through with it. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready. When I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Make sure today. Who should raise their hands? Maybe you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. Listen, you've been running away from God. Now it's time to stop, turn around, and start running to God. Today is your day. This is your day of salvation. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, from the front row to the back row, for you guys in the family rooms that you hear my voice, for those around the campus of the church in the Love Rock Cafe, wherever you're at home, online, on your phone, or on your computer, after the service is over, when you minimize the screen, you'll see a green button that says, or blue button that says, want to know God? Click that button if that's you. Just a moment. This is your moment. This is your time. Listen, you've had doctor's appointments. You've had dentist appointments and DMV appointments. This is a divine appointment right now between you and God. Don't wait another minute. I see hands already going up. In just a moment, that's you. I already got hands going up all over this place. I'm going to count. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'm going to count to three. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. One, two, three, four. I see that. Five, six, seven. I see that hand back there. Eight, nine, 10. I see you. 11, 12, 13, 14. I see you right there. 14 wise people. 15. I see you right over there in the back. 16 in the back row. I got you guys back there. 16. I got you right up here. 16 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? I see hands pointing over here. Give me a little wave so I can see your hand. Where are you guys at in this place? 17. All right. I see that hand. Anybody else? 18, 19. I see you. 20 back there in the back. In the family rooms, if that's you out there, I see people pointing over here. 21, I got you, sister. 21 wise people, anybody else? 22, I see you back there. 23, I see you back there. Where are you at in this place? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on, if that's you. 23 wise people, 24, I see you, my man. Anybody else in this place today? Where are you at, number 25? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on, if that's you, this is your moment, this is your time. If that's you in this place, stop playing games with God. Go forward in your relationship with Jesus Christ. This is it right here, right now. Where are you at, number 25? I can feel you in this place. Amen. I wonder if I should. Come on. Stop playing games with God. It's time to get serious with you. Number 25. Praise God. Hallelujah for 25 wise people. God is so good. Man. Here's what we're going to do. For all 25 of you that raised your hand, whether you're in the very back row or the front rows, wherever you're at, listen, you don't get saved by raising your hand. You say, man, this is what I want to do. I want to do this. In just a moment, we're all going to stand together. As we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody, look at them and say, hey, come with me. Or if you brought them, look at them and say, hey, I'll go with you. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Come meet me right here at the aisle. I want to shake your hand. I want to congratulate you. I want to pray together. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So come on, let's all stand together. Nobody leave if that's you. Come on, get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Come meet me right here today at the altar. Congratulations. This is your time. Congratulations.
Jesus, no,
yeah, you can come.
Back.
Come on, if that's you.
No, right on, turning back.
You can come.
Congratulations,
guys.
Follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
That's you. Come on, get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. This is you. This is your time.
The world behind me.
Congratulations.
No turning
back.
No turning
back. Come on, guys. That's you.
The cross before.
Can you help out, dude?
Me, no.
Look at you guys.
Back.
Come on, this is you.
No,
yeah. All over the place. Come on, if this is you, get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. This is your time.
To follow Jesus.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Look at you guys. Hey, you are one good-looking bunch of people. All right, a couple things I want to share with you. First and foremost, you're not going to a funeral, so you can wipe that frown upside down. All right, you're going to a birthday celebration. Today is your new birthday. You're going to get born again. All right, here's what I'm going to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you right over there. Nothing weird goes on, okay? I'm as weird as it gets. You made it through me. Simply, here's what he's going to do. He's going to, number one, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by making Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. You're going to ask him to come into your heart and come into your life. So he's going to lead you in a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information and literature. As you walk out of this place, you can say, what do I do now? We're going to point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you back to come and sit with a friend, an SPT. We call him spiritual personal trainers. You go to the gym, somebody that will come alongside of you, a personal trainer, help you get strong in muscles. We got spiritual personal trainers. Somebody will meet with you right over there in our cafe, buy you a cup of coffee, sit down with you, teach you some things about the Word of God for 5 simple weeks, give you a really cool Bible at the end of that to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you leave it all behind like we talked about. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth, that I am born again, I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.